This is Mike Fitzgerald introducing Dr. Norman Vincent Peale in the third of a series of talks designed to help you achieve personal success by giving you practical, tested ideas to help you reach your goals. In these talks, Dr. Peale shares with you some of the secrets of success he has discovered that could change your life. This talk is on how to reach your goals. Here is Dr. Norman Vincent Peale.
If I were to ask you, what is your goal in life, and urge you to give me a quick, succinct answer right off the top of your head, I wonder what your response might be. During this week, in preparation for a sermon on how to reach your goals, I have been putting that question to people, and perhaps have asked two or three dozen persons that question. I was having breakfast in a restaurant, and the waitress was a very interesting and dynamic young woman. She took my order, and before she could fold up her book and go to get it, I said to her, "Wait a minute, what's your goal?" She looked astonished. She said, "Okay, I can tell you. It's to raise my four girls to become decent, fine women." I said, "Like their mother." "And they're fortunate to have a mother like you." She gave me an extra helping of bacon for them. Then I met an advertising man named Pat O'Neill. And I said, "Pat, what's your goal?" He said, "It's to raise my seven boys into good Christian men." I said, "You're a Catholic, are you, Pat, to have that seven?" And he admitted that he was. He said, "I want them to grow up to be good Catholics, but beyond that, good Christians, and beyond that, decent human beings." I went to luncheon with six men and one woman, and I put the same question to them while they were in the midst of eating their soup. And I said, "I want this answer now." I passed out papers. The soup got cold, but I got my answer. And again, I put the same question to another group. And not one in all of the people that I spoke to said that their goal in life was to make a lot of money. Indeed, not one single person even mentioned money. But at this one luncheon, where there were the six men and one woman, I got these answers. To live fully, to function completely, to keep others alive, to help others live effectively. One man said to be the most effective direct mail fundraiser in America. He already is that. My goal is to be a happy and useful person, aware of my blessings and able to express my thanks to God always. My goal is to build the biggest and best book club in the United States. And that club has been started by us as the Good Reading Club. You ought to join it. This one is to help as many people as possible through the medium of words. He's a writer. And this one is, my goal is to be a successful writer and editor. And this one is from the woman, my own wife. I often wondered what her goal in life really was. On this paper, she wrote, "Persuade my husband not to work so long and hard and to take me a few places." Wouldn't it be interesting if we were to pass out these papers here this morning and ask everybody to write down what his or her goal in life is? Well, I can tell you this. I know what mine is. I've known for a good many years. I have absolutely no doubt about it. And this goal flashed on me once, some 37 or 8 years ago. Back in an era when the attitude toward religion wasn't as pious as it is generally supposed to be. I was speaking at a meeting one night here in New York City at the University Club to some kind of a group of young businessmen. The place was packed. I looked them over. They were all in their 30s maybe or early 40s. They were supposed to be the oncoming leaders of the business life of this community. And I was sitting beside the MC, a very debonair kind of a character, nice fellow. He was an Ivy League type from Westchester. And he said to me, you know something? This is the nearest I've ever been to a minister in my life. Well, I said, how come you've lived all these years without this extraordinary privilege? And the man on the other side said, well, Bill, you know, the only time I've ever been near a minister was when he married me to my wife. And I said, well, you fellas that go to church ever? Well, one of them said, I always make it a point to get there on Easter. Well, I said, that's really, church ought to be grateful to you for that. And the other one said, I go you one better than that. I get there Christmas Sunday as well. And they both admitted that they'd taken out their religion in their wife's name. An old shibboleth, which I used to hear a lot. So I looked out over this crowd and I said to them, how many of these fellas here do you suppose are regular churchgoers or have any connection with Christianity at all? And they kicked it around for a while, and finally they agreed that most of them were pretty nominal. Now I said, are these supposed to be the young leaders of the New York area? And they modestly agreed that maybe that was so. So right then and there, I had a terrific mental and spiritual experience. I decided that, so help me, what little I could do about it, I wasn't going to let the men of this generation get away with that. I decided that I was going to dedicate myself by every means possible to sell as many modern American men and women as I possibly could in my lifetime on the idea and the fact that really works. And at that time, there was a man around here by the name of Private Pete. He was the most famous private of World War I. And he was a great speaker. And he went all over the nation speaking as Private Pete. After that ran out, he started a lecture bureau. And he came to me one day and he said, Norman, how about taking the message out of the church and getting it over to business groups all over everywhere? I said, I'm for that, provided it doesn't take up my time away from the church too much. So anyway, I started out with him speaking to business conventions and sales organizations and conventions, and think I've done about as much of that as anybody. I won't say how effectively, all over this country in all the years that have succeeded. And I'm glad to report that as a result of it, I don't believe you could go into any meeting of men today and have them talk to you on that flippant way as they did years ago. I remember the time when they wouldn't even have had a preacher before a business convention, and I've remembered the time where he would have been fearful to say anything about God. The climate is entirely different, not what it ought to be yet. But believe me, there's been a change, because it is now well recognized that Jesus Christ is the most subtle, sophisticated character that the world has ever known. So it's very important to have a goal in life. You can reach your goals. You can achieve your objectives. You can realize your purposes, provided that you have goals and objectives and purposes. You never can reach them unless you have them. And provided also that your goals, objectives, and purposes are right. For if they're not right, they're wrong, and nothing wrong ever turns out right. I believe that it's the function of the church to help people to get the most out of life by reaching their goals. I did a strange thing not long ago. Really did me a lot of good. I was talking to a friend of mine named Fred Edgar, who's the pastor of a church in Dallas, Texas. And Fred, who's a very effervescent man, told me that one night he was very low in spirit. And he told me why. But he said, I found a way to get a tremendous lift. He told me that he went into the empty, semi-dark sanctuary of his big church down there in Dallas. And he started down the main aisle. And his is a residential type of church, and not many strangers from outside. And he knows everybody in the congregation. He's been there for about 30 years. He's married them all. He's baptized them all. He's been with them in all the circumstances of life. He said he went down the aisles, and Mary sat over here, and he prayed for Mary. And Jack sat over here, and he went over and put his hand on the pew where Jack sat and prayed for him. Went back there to where Harry sat, put his hand on Harry's pew, and so on down through the congregation. That impressed me. So I came in here not long ago myself. I didn't spend too much time at it, but I went down the up and down the aisles here, and I said, I want Elsie and Otto and Harry and Lynn and his dear wife to get the most out of life. And I went down here and I said, I pray for Martin and Helen that they may get the most out of life. Bill and Helen, and Lorraine, and Cecilia, and Leslie. I'm just pointing out people that I see right now, but I mentioned most of them and sent out loving thoughts to them. Well, you know, that refreshed me no end. And then I began to ask myself, they've been listening to me preach sermons all these years. Are they any better because they've listened to me? And is their life any richer and more meaningful because I, together with Arthur here, others have been able to break the bread of life? Every human being's got to have a goal, something you're reaching for, something you expect to attain, whatever it may be. And according to the statement of the Bible, that if you have faith and believe, That which you seek can come to you. Like those two blind men. They were blind. They'd heard about all the miracles that Jesus was performing, and they followed him. And the disciples said, let's get rid of these people. They're a nuisance. And Jesus said, let them talk to me. And he said to them, what do you fellows want? They said, we're blind. We want to see. He said, do you believe that I can give you sight? They said, yes, sir, we do believe. And he said, because of your faith, let it be as you ask. So whatever your great desire is, if you believe that he can do it for you, you go to him and you say, I want this. And if you really believe, it shall be as you ask. So then, to reach your goals, what method do we take beyond this? First is to have a specific goal, not a fuzzy goal, but one that is clearly and sharply defined, so that you can write it down in a word or a sentence or two, and then put a date on it when you want it to come to pass. Because that which you want, added to that which you believe, if you take it to the Lord, he will bring it to pass. Now, about 4 months ago, I was walking down a street in Denver, Colorado. I go out every day wherever I am and take a 2-mile walk if it is possible. And it's only impossible when it's pouring down rain, as far as I'm concerned. And even then, I just shorten it up a bit. I remember I came out of a hotel in Los Angeles one night, and I said to the doorman, how far is 1 mile down this street? He and the taxi driver talked it over, and they said, it's down to Western Avenue. I said, if I walk down there, that's 1 mile. If I walk back, that's 2 miles. And the doorman said, that's pretty good addition. So when I came back, finally, he said, you're the most curious guy I ever met in my life. How come? I asked. He said, you're the first one that ever came out of this hotel and asked me how long was a 2-mile walk. All of them asked for a taxi. And I said, I do it to keep in shape. And he was impressed when he looked me over. So at any rate, I was walking down the street in Denver when I saw this man coming toward me, and he had his hand outstretched. He was a nice-looking young fella, early in his 30s, no doubt, and he grabbed my hand and he said, isn't it great to see you here? He says, my mother reads everything you write. I said, what do you read? Oh, he said, where are you going? I said, back to the hotel. And he walked along with me. I said, what are you doing? Oh, he said, times are bad. I'm looking for a job. What kind of a job, I asked. Oh, he said, I don't know. Any old kind of a job, anybody that'll give me any work to do. I said, you don't care what? No, he said, just so it brings in a little money. Well, I said, when do you expect to get this job? He said, I haven't the slightest idea. I've been walking around these streets for days. And I said, you haven't yet decided what kind of a job you want or when you're going to get it. Is that the idea? He said, what's that got to do with it? I said to him, do you really want a job? Do you really believe that with God's help you can get a job? Well, he said, yes, I believe that. I said, well, then, let's take out a piece of paper, I said, and write down the kind of a job you want. Describe it to me. I'll write it as you describe it. Well, he said, you know, if I really got what I wanted, I'd like to be a salesman. And I said, what do you want to sell? Oh, he said, you know, I think I could sell insurance. Yeah, he says, I'd like to be an insurance salesman. But you see, I haven't got any brains, and I haven't got much education. I said, don't tell me what you haven't got. Tell me what you want. He said, I want to be an insurance salesman. I said, when do you want to begin? Well, I said, I don't know. Well, I said, how about saying that you'd like to begin next week, Thursday morning? And I wrote that down, wants to start next week, Thursday morning. Well, he says, where am I going to get an insurance job? I said, at an insurance agency. He said, I never thought about that. He said, do you think that I can get it? I said, yes. Do you think you can get it? He said, now that I'm talking to you, I believe I can. I said, go get it and let me know about it. He finally got in touch with me. He said, I didn't get it on Thursday. I got it the following Monday, but I'm on the job. And he added, I'm going to be the greatest insurance salesman in Denver, Colorado. I believe he will. But wandering aimlessly around with no goal and no time element on it, one could hardly expect other than that it wouldn't happen. But if you have faith and really believe in the Lord and in yourself and in life itself and in your country and in the day and age in which you live, you can reach your goal. But you've got to make it specific. I really wish I could come down there and say, what's your goal? One sentence. But you don't need to tell it to me. Just tell it to yourself. If you have faith in Him, you shall have what you believe, He said to the blind man. And He says that too to us. But in order to attain and reach one's goals, it has to be treated on a spiritual basis. Because our goals are related to our persons. And person only is guided by spiritual understanding in the deeper sense of the word. A man who was having a great deal of trouble in reaching his goals told me that he was in a motel, a Holiday Inn, he told me, where always they have an open Bible. And some of those innkeepers have said that they pray about where they open the Bible. This man paced up and down his room, and he saw this Bible, and he'd seen them in many a motel, but he had never read them. But on this occasion, he picked the book up, and he started to read. Finally, he read the two pages to which the book lay open on the dresser. He turned to other sections of the Bible. He told me that he read this Bible for nearly an hour. Something that he had never been accustomed to do. Finally, he said, he sat there and a strange kind of wisdom seemed to float up in his mind. A perceptiveness, illumination, understanding, his goals clarified. He got an idea as to what he should do. He went out and proceeded to do it and had a glorious result. What had happened to him was that his mentality had been reconditioned with a basic wisdom and understanding. You can reach your goal provided you know what the goal is, and provided it's a right goal, and provided you get the supportive power. So get out of life the most that there is in it for you, and there's plenty if you follow his guidance.